Thanks, Dr. Oswalt, for joining us, and Nathan as well. So in your lecture, you argued quite strongly about the importance of finding creation ex nihilo in Genesis 1. So I'm going to play devil's advocate for a little bit.
Please do.
And just see how you respond to something that I've been wondering about. So given that we affirm revelation is progressive, that we are able to see truths more clearly at later points in redemptive history. So, for example, this side of the incarnation, the doctrine of the Trinity becomes clearer than on the other side. Given that we affirm that about revelation, for someone who doesn't see creation ex nihilo in Genesis 1, but does see it later on in the biblical corpus, whether in later parts of the Old Testament or even in the New Testament, what's wrong with that view?
Well, I think what's wrong with it is the data. As I said, the only just bald-faced, in-your-face declaration that God made everything from nothing is in Maccabees. You do not find, the closest you come, as I said, is in Hebrews, where it says he made everything visible from what was not visible. Well, the critic will say, yeah, you're talking about invisible matter. Just because something was invisible doesn't mean it didn't exist. Lots of invisible things exist. So that's where they're going to come back and say, you don't have any absolutely flat-out assertion of creatio ex nihilo in the canon. So here's where Gerhard Mays comes along and says, yeah, it's in the second century AD when these fathers and mothers are confronting Hellenism, that they create this doctrine to fight it. So that's really the problem, that it's just not clear enough in the biblical account. And that's why I want to argue, I think they're all saying, well, of course we believe in creatio ex nihilo. We don't need to make a point of it. It's there. That's where it comes from. That's what I think is going on, you know, because I think that is the question. Well, if creatio ex nihilo is as critical to transcendence as Oswalt wants to make it, why isn't it argued much more intensively throughout the scripture? My answer is they're saying we don't need to because it is so foundational there at the very outset. So that's really where I would come through. Now, I think you can say that the fathers in the second century, like the fathers in the third century, are saying, we need to make more of this biblical doctrine because of what we're facing. We need to codify it. We need to put it in order, what is there in a variety of ways. And I would see that as the progress of revelation, that yes, they are seeing much more clear, and very analogous to the Trinity then, is, okay, how do we organize all these things the Bible is saying about the Godhead? This is the way we do it. How do we bring together all these things that are implied, that are assumed, that are alluded to, that are understood? Yeah. So that's the way I'd come at it.
That's helpful. Nathan, you've been researching on this topic a little bit. So is your understanding similar, a little different?
To answer the original question of why is it problematic not to find creation from nothing in Genesis 1, the historical case is that the church up through the period of the Reformation, when someone wanted to talk about the doctrine of creation, they did it by commenting on Genesis 1 through 3. Yeah. So Augustine, of course, wrote a number of commentaries on Genesis. Aquinas and his Summa has a long section going through the 6 days. Calvin and Luther both wrote commentaries on Genesis rather than discrete doctrines of creation, as it were. And so the fact is that when the church formulates its doctrine of creation from nothing, it's by engaging Genesis 1. That's not to say that the doctrine couldn't stand on its own apart from Genesis 1, But it at least makes me wary if the doctrine has become disconnected from the classic text,
yes,
from which we as a tradition derived it. So that's that gets at why I think we need to come back and read it in line with Genesis 1. I think that it does help at this point then to engage some sort of a notion of multiple readings of a chapter, where you could say maybe on the first glance, Genesis 1, you know, the first time you open the Bible and you've only read Genesis 1, you may not find creation out of nothing.
Exactly.
Once you've read through and you've finished the last page of the Bible and you go back and start again, you have a whole bunch more sense of who the God is who creates. And as Dr. Oswalt has been helpfully pointing out, you have all these notions of God's transcendence, of his goodness, of his radical power. And when you bring all that to bear, the identity of the God who in the beginning created, it does shape the way you understand what that means for him to create. So I think that to some extent, perhaps, the early church read within a different framework than the modern historical critic. And so rather than reading Genesis 1 on its own terms, it's reading it within this broader context, reading it as scripture,
yes,
reading it with reference to the Christ event,
yes,
these other things. So there is some broader hermeneutical framework that's bearing pressure on the reading of Genesis 1. And I think that does help explain why some people can read Genesis 1 and not find it, and others read it and do find it. There's different frames of reference that the text is being read within.
Yeah. Yeah, I think that's absolutely right, and I've had some discussions on this point with regard to my paper. People saying, "Well, where is it explicitly stated?" And I say it's not explicitly stated, but I'm still going to argue, as I did in the lecture, this is the necessary conclusion when you put the various components of these statements together. That you can't go anywhere else. If God pre-existed matter and God made the world as something new, then he made it out of nothing.
So do you think that it's possible to build off both of those, that our current divisions within theological disciplines have contributed to this questioning? So, for example, a reader who looks at Genesis 1 in isolation from the rest of the canonical context and only informed by ancient Near Eastern parallels,
oh, yes,
maybe they're not going to find ex nihilo there.
In fact, they're going to work not to find it because of the assumption, well, it's not in the other ancient Near Eastern literature, so how could it be in this literature?
So getting to your point in the lecture about accounting for the differences between what we find in scripture and what we find in other ancient Near Eastern documents.
Yeah. Yeah.
So in that case, I think it would be a fair assumption, and if I'm wrong, push back, that the current divisions between the theological disciplines, between theology and biblical studies, might be contributing to some of our questions about this.
Very definitely.
Yeah.
Very definitely.
Yeah. I'll let the editors splice out how these two answers work together. But
yeah.
I mean, speaking for my own tradition as Reformed Presbyterian, I think that to some extent our maybe somewhat weak doctrine of creation comes from the fact that Luther and Calvin discussed creation by writing commentaries on Genesis. Mm-hmm. But then when you enter the Reformed scholastic period, it's, you know, reflecting on the institutes where there really isn't a strong section on creation, at least not as strong as some of the other doctrines. And so when you start writing theology and stop writing Genesis commentaries, you kind of lose some of this doctrine of creation. So I think seeing that split come out of the Reformation, where you do have specialized fields, has contributed to some of this neglect of the doctrine of creation in Reformed traditions. On the second issue of distinctiveness and of Genesis vis-a-vis ancient Near Eastern literature and these things that, as you alluded to in your lecture, there is this back and forth where the biblical theology movement very strongly emphasized that only the distinctive parts of Scripture are really the inspired part, as it were, though they probably wouldn't use the language of inspiration. But that's really where the meat of Scripture is in the distinctive elements. And the pendulum's kind of come back the other way to say, well, you know, there's a lot of things that are not distinctive in the Old Testament that do fit fairly well within the ancient Near Eastern context. And you're kind of almost, there's almost a hesitancy on our part as Old Testament scholars today to actually say, yes, this is just a distinct element within the Old Testament. And so the real balance, it seems to me, is that we need to both, our goal reading the Old Testament, especially for those of us who are reading it as scripture, is to read everything that's there, whether it's distinctive or not distinctive. And so we need to both emphasize, you know, be willing to say, yes, this is a distinctive element, but we also need to say, this part might be shared with another culture, and yet it is nevertheless part of God's word to us today. And so that is the tough balance, I think, in our discipline today.
Yeah, I think, for me, the classic example is the tripartite temple.
Yes.
The temple structure, as far as we can see, is identical to the Canaanite structure, which again, I think, makes sense in terms of incarnation. God is using whatever he can use without it corrupting the truth he's trying to convey, but that tripartite structure is not the key to the temple. The key to the temple is there's no idol in the Holy of Holies. There's a golden box with a covenant in it. Where else are you going to find that in the ancient world? And so I think you're exactly right that there's a danger in the point that I'm trying to make, that we say, well, there really aren't any similarities. Yes, there are. There are lots of them. But those similarities, they can help us in understanding what God is doing. They are not essential to what God is saying.
That's really helpful. Thanks so much for sitting down with us, Dr. Oswalt and Nathan.